Also, a very important thing has happened that big players in the industry have started to look into producing for holographic material. Harman technology, which we will hear later this morning about, and also Bayer photopolymer are big interest now in getting into the market. So I will talk a little about that, and of course details you will hear from Karin Harvey, who represents Harman technology. So, but first I want to talk about what is happening in the recording of color holograms. I work at the Center for Modern Optics at Optic. Some of you attended the International Symposium there in 2006 when we had the previous ISDH meeting there. But many of my new friends from China and so have probably not been to any of these events. So I will discuss here a little about the problem we have. I mean, I have always dreamed of making like you do in acoustic waves. Today you can record sound extremely well and replay it. You can sit at home and listen as if you were in a concert hall. I want to do exactly the same thing with light waves. So I want to create ultra-realistic imaging. And this is not directly for art, unless artists would like to do it, but it is really for the museums to be able to show artifacts anywhere in the world, anywhere without any security aspects. And can we do it today? We are on the borderline now. Main problem is with previous material is light scattering, because if you use materials that scatter light, you can't record blue light, really, so you need to have something that don't scatter. We have multiple storage, so we will have more, three or more recordings in the same emulsion. You may suffer from emulsion shrinkage, which may affect the colors when you replay them. You also have so often some increased bandwidth when you reconstruct them, which means that you get desaturation of colors. And the fourth problem, which we have treated theoretically recently, is what wavelengths you need for color holograms. So everybody knows this, how you calculate the interference structure and you have to record. So I'm not going through it. This is a formula, and if you put in lambda 400, you find that you need 7,600 lines per millimeter. And that means that any of the old materials, they normally stopped at 3 or 4,000. So, and another demonstration of that you can see here. This is actually the best way to test a new candidate for color hologram. You don't need to make a hologram. All you need is to put something in front of an object and illuminate it with your white or blue laser light. Here is just the object. Here is glass plate. Here is an ultra-fine super resolution plate in front of the object that should look identical to a glass plate. And this is an old commercial material, Agfa plate, with around grain size, around 45 nanometer. So you see, you can never get a better hologram than what you see here, because that scatter will be recorded in your hologram. We did the work here with a PhD student that we published last year in Applied Optics. So this is all theory, excluding the material itself. So what you see here, these are the optimum three wavelengths, 4, 5, 6, and 7 wavelengths, to minimize the color error. This is published in Applied Optics in February 2008, if you are interested in the details of that investigation. We are using the Macbeth target, so we illuminate the target in white light, laser light, and color hologram of that target. As you can already see, going from white light to just three laser light doesn't reproduce the colors we see them in white light. There are differences, as you can see. And then there are differences related to the material here. So these are the problem. I mean, it has to look like that, laser illuminated and hologram and white light. Then we have reached our goal. Here you can see how dramatic we reduce a color error going from 3 to 4 or 5 wavelengths. What this is the error of each individual patch of the, so we calculate the average error on each of these patches. And of course, some, depending on the wavelengths, will have a bigger error and smaller errors. But you average it, you see that values are presented. So three lasers, that's, we can't really think that we have reproduced the colors as accurate, because the eye can see a difference between this color hologram and the object next to it. The goal is, of course, when the human eye can't see the difference, you have a ask people, you put the object behind a glass plate and a hologram and ask people, tell me which one is which. You have to get the 50-50 distribution, you have achieved your goal. Okay, let's now talk about the materials. The problem we have here is severe problem that we don't have the materials we need for recording these type of holograms. Slavish has been providing plates for quite some time. In the beginning, they had very good plates when I started. Now it's not really possible to make use it, because the manager who was in charge has formed a new company called Sveres, and he provides the all type of material, primarily for the pulsed recordings for the printed holograms. You will hear more about from Stas here later when he talk about Yola. But I have also now been able to get glass plates from Sveres, which I have been working on. Now we can take a look at the producers of monochrome or some polychromatic color holographic. Mike Medora in London produce very good materials, although I don't think he has really started to commercialize panchromatic material. Filmotech in Germany produced material. Harman, you will hear about, is going to introduce now again materials. This is a company who make Millimask type that Ron Olson, for example, have used for a lot of his pulse green holograms. Slavish, as I said, still produce. Sveres is a strong candidate. Ultimate Holography, both in France and in Canada, produce material, although they don't sell panchromatic material, only monochrome. And what we had done in the meantime, a few years ago, we started a European project to develop 10 nanometer grain size silver halide with these partners. This is where I work now, and this is Martin Richardson's company in London. We have representative from Bulgaria, Klosby, here, and then the University Liège in Belgium. Kristoyanov was coating our glass plates because he has excellent coating facilities. Vivid Components was the managing company, and Yola Vilnius is also represented here by Stas. So he may tell you more about these things. So we have been, I'm not going to enter in details, just give you a glimpse of what how we make emulsion. This is you have water and gelatin, and you add silver nitrate and potassium bromide, potassium iodide in a beaker. And if you noticed here, they are entered at different levels in the beaker, and they have to be done extremely quickly with peristatic pumps. So in less than a minute, we have to mix this to get these small grains. And that is a problem when you want to scale it up for mass production. A key part of this is the freezing thawing. So when the emulsion is done, it's put into ice cubes here in a freezer overnight. And then you thaw it, and this can be repeated more than once. So when you melt it here, you first clean the emulsion. A lot of water is coming out, and you get higher concentration of superfine grains. And also silver or potassium nitrate and byproducts are washed out, so you get at the same time the washing. And then, of course, you have to add sensitizing dyes to the emulsion to make it panchromatic. And after that, you have to coat them. In our lab, we mainly do manual coating for tests. We can't really do any professional coating, but a lot are the tests to perfect the emulsion. As I mentioned in our Silvercross project, the plates were coated by Stoyanov in Germany, as well as we had some coating done by Harman Technology, who has excellent coating facilities in UK. And these are tests that show what happened with our grains from the different stages. So these are grains in the order of 10 nanometer from, so there is no grain grow during this process, as you can see, after precipitation, after towing, after sensitizing and coating. So they maintain the grain size, which is very important. Okay, let me now talk about photopolymer materials. You have been familiar primarily with DuPont over many years. We have Zebra, for example, have been lucky to be able to buy these materials over many years and produce very nice printed hologram and so on. Most people can't buy any DuPont anymore. That's the reason why Bayer realized that there is a market for producing material that will have unlimited access. Anybody can order it. There is no restrictions like DuPont. And I have been involved with a project with them to test it. We have a scientist from Bayer, Andy Volko, worked with us in our labs to test and develop them for Bayer over 2 years. So we have done extensive work on it. And Bayer photomaterial is actually, will be commercially introduced next year, hopefully. It's not 100% clear, but most likely. And that material is actually the material that is used for the data storage. The disks that 3M is making now has Bayer's material on it. And of course, they have gone severe testing to be suitable for data storage. And in particular, this material is not allowed to have any shrinkage whatsoever, which is a great advantage for color holography in compared to the DuPont that you have 4 or 5% shrinkage. And also the Bayer material can't use, needs no processing, because in a data storage, you record it and it's done. So you don't need heat treatment, you don't need UV curing or anything like that. That's a fantastic material to work with. And here you can see some of the figures I have been having on the experimental material. This doesn't mean that this is going to be what you buy or get from them. By the way, they are willing, they are not selling anything, but people who are interested can contact them for free samples for testing if you are involved in holography in any way. But anyhow, you can see they have achieved the opposite to DuPont. They have high red sensitivity, we are not happy with this distribution. We want them much more isochromatic. But anyhow, that's the material we have. The substrate have been polycarbon 175 micron thickness. Polymer layers now for all the experimental material has been 70 microns. And they will deliver them in just now rolls 26 centimeter by 500 meter. But later they introduce it in rolls 1.2 meter by 100 meter for mass production of large holograms. One of the things we are interested in is mass production of printed holograms into polymer as well as analog holograms. So we are looking forward very much to this. The price, according to them, will be in the order of 30 to 50 euros per square meter if you order these rolls, of course. Smaller quantities will be more expensive. And they promise 3 to 4 weeks delivery. When they start, they have not started yet. So, okay. Now we have to think, if you have material, so who can record holograms? Unfortunately, when I talk about color holograms now, of the analog or printed type, one problem with color holography is that we don't have so many people who can produce them. As we discussed yesterday, and so artists is now taking advantage of these centers to have holograms made. And I think for artists, these printed full-color holograms you have seen from Rabbit Halls or from Yola will open a completely new way for artists without investing much money in a lab, can create fantastic thing and use these centers. If you look at them now, Center for Modern Optics, we are building a printer there for a project, so that will be ready later this year. That's where I work. Then you have a color holographic in Mike Medora's company do primarily transmission stereograms and so for advertising, but he's also started doing reflection and is going into full color reflection. Dai Nippon has been producing holograms a long time, mainly security volume holograms, stickers and so on, in their own polymer produced by Nippon Paint. Then you have Dutch Holographic Lab has also started producing a system that I think Peter Jung has in Cologne. Then you have Eola, of course, the main behind all these developments in both previously XYZ and now Rabbit Holes. And also Eola is a company who provide access to Russian materials. So if you're interested in Svar Essence, so he is a distributor of these materials. Louis Pasteur University is where I set it up together with Dalibor Vukacevic when we did our early investigation of color holography. Rabbit Holes, you heard from Mike Page here. Yeah, Michael Page talked about it yesterday. I don't know if there is any other presentation on that. And a very interesting thing has happened in Canada now. It's that Bayer has started already with ultimate holographic reproductions to provide photopolymer for copying masters into a full-color hologram. So ultimate holographic reproduction will start producing color holograms in a larger scale. Then we have emulsion companies like Ultimate Holographer, Chantier in France, although Chantier doesn't sell any material panchromatic, so it's not a source for people who want to buy it, but he makes excellent holograms himself. And of course, Zebra Imaging has been in the business, but they have the unique possibility to buy DuPont that none of us can do, so they are unique in themselves there. Then let's see how we do the color holograms. We have a krypton, and of course this is only three colors. I need to add at least one more or maybe two more lasers to get the perfect color reproduction. But let's see how it is now. We have krypton 647, 532, frequency double, neodymium YAG, and an argon ion 476. The reason for 476 is still the compromise of scattering. It would be better to go with lower, but you know how dramatic the scatter works. Even of silver halide 4 grains, you get some scatter. We have not achieved a perfect recording with shorter wavelengths, so which may be from other reasons better. And then we combine them with dielectric beam combiners to make a white laser light. Make the normal Denisuk setup and record behind the plate. The Denisuk is of the preference for museums, of course, because that's how you display things. I mean, you put something behind glass, it's never out there floating somewhere. So, and also Denisuk has 180 degree in both dimension, extremely important for museums. So here you can see the lasers. It's from Coherent, argon, neodymium YAG, and the krypton. We, of course, want to replace these two tremendous consuming water and electricity to three of this type, if it's possible, in the future, so we can move things to museums and so on. Here is the white laser beam going from the laser room into the recording room, which is in this and another floating table, synchronized with the floating table where the lasers are. This means that we can completely get rid of all the noise from the lasers. In my experience, I never put a laser on the same table I record because a laser itself is the worst vibrator you can put, in particular these argon and krypton lasers. So we can now work in a completely silence in this room. And then nevertheless, we need all this foam to isolate it from air turbulence, even if the current. This is something is completely neglected by most. It's very cheap investment. Just isolate the table with these type of blocks around your setup and you will be much more successful. And then we use spectrophotometers to measure the color content of holograms we have recorded. It's the one from Photo Research. This is good because it is works like a video camera, so you can go in and look in the image with a little cross to see where you take your measurements. So it's very convenient to use that system. And then we come to the other extremely difficult problem is how do you illuminate your holograms? That has been the problem in holography from the very beginning, and it still, in my opinion, is the main problem, because we can deal with, we can have four or five lasers, we can have excellent recording, but then you spoil everything if you can't set up the correct illumination. And I don't really know how this can be solved. I can see that we can only work with fixed installations where you have done it correctly. So hologram and spotlight are fixed, and then it works. But forget about putting it on a cover of a book or something. Nobody will ever get the right. In color holography, it's even more important, because if you don't have the right light, you don't get the right colors. Most of us have used these type of halogen lights that emit a spectrum like that, much less, more in red than in blue. And this has been the standard MR16 and so, and we still use them a lot, of course, and they are good. I mean, it's not to explain, but still they are not perfect. So what has come out now is a new Welch Allen solar micro arc lamp, which I have tested. It's extremely interesting light for, because it's such a tiny little thing which may make a very high color temperature, and it is low voltage, 6,500 to 13,700 Kelvin. So we can produce holograms now with much better color content. And the only drawback with this so far is a low, short lifetime. You can have a look at such a light. I brought one here. So this lamp I put on Paula Dawson's hologram when I was in Yola, and we saw a brand new hologram coming out of that huge 1.2 by 2 meter. Stars can also tell you. Unfortunately, I didn't take any photographs of it, but I will show you that hologram later. So this has a miniature arc, and it also means that we get a perfect, much sharper holograms with this light. But the lifetime is a problem, and I hope they can solve that. This is how the light looks like. So it is the little arc is sitting here, a few millimeter, and then it have a very good reflector, narrow beam. So you can have it far away from the hologram and focus it. That means super sharp images. Then, of course, we are also looking at the new LED lights for color holograms. We are looking into matching the LEDs with the recording wavelengths. That will be the ultimate solution for reflection hologram, because there you will only illuminate the fringes that were used. That means that all the light that illuminates a plate and make noise now in between the wavelengths is gone. You will get super high contrast images if we can develop this, and we are working on that with manufacturers trying to solve this problem. Here we have, of course, in opposite to the arc lamp, we have extremely long lifetime, so you don't need to wait. You don't get a lot of heat generated. You can also, low energy, no much electricity used, no infrared or UV. That means you don't print out silver holograms. And you can also get very good directional control. So I hope that LEDs, white LEDs or mixed LEDs will be the future for color holograms, and of course in installations in museums and so on. Now I want to show you some results of our Silver Cross emulsion that was done during the Silver Cross. This is the photo of that hologram recorded in the Silver Cross emulsion, and here is spectrum. So this is the object, this is the hologram. This, of course, is now illuminated with the halogen light, so you get this distribution. Of course, when you illuminate with three lasers recorded, you get three spikes coming out. But if they are properly matched, you get sort of rather good white balance, as you can see there. The quality of this hologram is not that bad, but probably even from photographs, you could say which one is a hologram. First of all, you see this thing we always have a problem with. If the plate is not big enough, you get a shadow of the edge. So that is a hint which is a hologram, but nevertheless, it's not perfect. And then we have this is another I used because it has a lot of blue in it, which is critical to record. And here you can see a spectrum from this part where you have, you see now we have much more blue content in the distribution. Here you can see also that we have absolutely no shrinkage in our silver cross emulsion. So when we process them, they come back with 647, 532, 476, and no individual unevenness in the emulsion. This has taken a lot of work to try to get these things working. And displaying holograms, as I said, is fixed installation, is the only thing I can see of in any holograms, color holograms in the future, unless somebody come up with integrated illumination like Edgelit, that can be. But it also seemed struggled for years and years, and nobody have a solution. And also, of course, as I said here, very often, I mean, since you have big hologram, you have to have the light source far away, so you need really to put it up in the ceiling. I mean, these normally extremely long arms coming out looks very ugly, and it doesn't really give justice to a nice installation. Now we come to 3D art reproductions, which is my main interest. And here we have, of course, the possibility to see that we can reproduce, which I will talk about, this new museum project in UK. But one thing is, which artists may not be that interested in, to make a reproduction of the real world. You want to do something, you want to manipulate that. You record light or you generate light from the hologram that has never existed and you get an output when you store it. That's a digital technique. And there is a few maybe interest to make this for some combination of ultra realistic with added features to it that could be done. But that's up to the artists to think what how they can use this new color technique, analog technique as well as the digital. And what I can see is, of course, that there will be a possibility to show these beautiful things like Fabergé eggs anywhere. You can promote an exhibition in a museum of the real thing in the tube station. You can have it at the airport. Come to this museum and look at these fantastic things we will show you. Another thing is art education. You can think that every art institute in the world could have 100 of the most prestigious pieces of art to for the students to look under magnifying glass without having to travel around the world. So there is a lot that could happen in holography in the coming 10, 50 years. Let me show this is a cuneiform from Germany, and these are very rare things. So they can't really use photographs, so they have to have the real thing to show the scientists who want to read it. Now, if you make a color hologram of it, you can send the color hologram. They can tilt it around and get the reflection so they can read the signs. So they are very interested in this type of work. Here is another example of which may be related to this conference, is an example of how good we can do white in our technique. And then this is another example of demonstration, which people are very amazed when they see this because they can't believe that this is a hologram. I also have a video of it here for those who have seen. This is the best way, in addition to maybe showing the real thing, because here you can really see how the reflections are moving in the same way as they would if the objects would be behind the glass. So in my opinion, there is a great future for color holography if we can solve the recording material display of them that, and the laser wavelengths, of course. We have been, during the Silver Cross project, we worked with the artifacts from the National History Museum in London, and we recorded some pieces for them. That's where we started the interest from them, to see that holography may be something. They heard about it in the 1780s. They rejected it completely because of the lack of colors, and so now they have been interested. So we have a new project here in UK now calling Bringing the Artifacts Back to the People. It's funded by the Esme Fairbairn Foundation, and it will involve primarily Wales now, since I work there and we have got funding there, from the National Museum of Wales, British Museum in London is extremely interested, which I will show you, Maritime Museum in Liverpool, and the Royal Commission for Ancient and Historical Monuments in Wales. And we also look into some of the digital technique. For example, big sculptures could be recorded and produce life size in the digital recorded. Because when you do digital hologram, big ones, you don't need to have the super resolution you need for the small objects. That's why digital holography in this application, it will only go for the very large type of things. And then you have seen this hologram in the exhibition, this decorated horse Yvonne. It was found in Kenrick's cave in Llandudno in Wales. It now belongs to the British Museum in London because it's one very old piece. It's dated by carbon-14 to between 13,000 to 14,000 year old. And it was recorded at on the April the 21st in the Center for Modern Optics. You can see some of the recording. Here is a bone under the silver halo plate. This is a lady from the museum and me and my colleagues. And this is a photograph of the one you have seen in the exhibition. I need to be fast here because I am the chairman. I have to keep a track on things. So Jill Cook is actually the deputy keeper of prehistory and early European and British Museum at the British Museum. And she said that the British Museum is committed to sharing the collection as widely as possible in the UK and across the world. This new technology provides another opportunity for people to engage with the collection. It is an important step to wider access. And that is what it is. Give people a choice to see these things without having to travel around the world. Let them see them where they are, because we have the technology or will have the technology within coming years. Now let me say a few words with computer-generated color holograms. You will hear much more about this. You have heard a lot from artists, but I want to comment on a few things here. First of all, of course, the analog hologram is superior to any computer-generated hologram because you can't store the information that we store in an analog yet because of the resolution. We talk about pixels, 1.1 millimeter square. I mean, we would talk about pixels in the order of nanometers in analog holography. That's why we can make these tiny, small things extremely realistic with analog holography. And of course, in my opinion, we should never play with magnification in a hologram when you come to the museum. If a piece is a certain size, that's the size you see in the museum, and you don't need to put a matchbox next to it. The eye will immediately know the size of it. That's another thing that contributes to the super realistic imaging that I am working on. But of course, today we can work with holographic stereograms, which is a common thing for, or completely computer-generated. We either take a camera, go along a line and record a scene, and then transfer that into a printed hologram. Or you use completely computer-generated, which you have seen examples from rabbit holes yesterday. And there are holographic printers around the world. Yola Digital is one who make printers. We are making one printer now at Optic based on the Yola technology. Zebra Imaging have their own printers. And of course, Rabbit Hole, they have the old XYZ printers that were done by Yola and is now run by that new company who took over when they went bankrupt, the old XYZ. So this hologram can, as you have seen, a large field of view. Zebra, of course, has been doing both horizontal and vertical parallax. I think that some of you have seen what Chang bought, a little map, because maps for military application is the main use for them now to produce military maps that can even be brought out of the field for the soldiers to look at. If you look at art holography now, as I said, analog holography, like putting an object behind the glass and make an art piece, is probably not that attractive. Either what you put behind it is an art piece in itself, and then the artist is only doing a reproduction of it. But you could maybe do what Anaïte is one of the few I know who took advantage of full-color holography. She created a pseudoscopic image or object of this flag. We recorded a Denisyuk type of hologram, and when you put it up, this flag is actually floating in front of the stars are coming off it, falling down there from the flag. And this is really another example that Dieter Jung talked about, is flying colors. I mean, you know, national flags are really flying colors around the world. And here is an example of how Anaïte looked into the problem in America where the stars are falling. Anyhow, now we have heard about rabbit holes. Mike Page talked about all these artists that are utilizing this technique, so I shouldn't really talk about that now. But I have brought one example from Alex Alvarez, which I think is rather interesting, the kiss, because this is something that would be difficult to generate an object of. Instead, you use art, digital computer generating, and I think you can create the most fantastic, surrealistic or whatever objects or art in 3D now. And then I want to also mention about Paula Dawson's huge scale use of this luminescence presence, which I saw in Geola when I brought this little lamp to change it and put this in, a completely different image appeared. If it's better or not, it's up to Paula to say. But what we saw, of course, first of all, these stars, which should be unsharp, they become very sharp suddenly. And the colors, the blue and the whites and so on, even Stas may comment on this because he was amazed how different the hologram looked. And then Martin Richardson has also started to work in this field. He used Geola, and this is one of example. You saw it in the exhibition. So this is not just a portrait. It's something added to it, which makes it much more interesting. And I think that's where we will see the future for artists, since they don't need to have any equipment, only fantasy and computer graphics. And the future of color holography is that there are two futures. One is for this museum, maybe advertising exhibition using analog holography, and the other is really the digital techniques. And if you go back to the first, I mean, there is absolutely nothing that can beat. We don't have photography, computer graphics or so, are far from super realistic. Only holography can actually take the light waves that we see and recreate them. So that's what this little holographic plate can do, and it can replay it for eternity, what you saw in an instant like millions of years ago. So it's really fantastic. How I know Carl Friedrich Reuter said was very fascinated when we did a hologram of himself in the plate. Actually, we made a hologram where you could see the plate that was being recorded, and he saw that as an extremely interesting thing, because when you look at it, you see the plate before or when it was exposed, and that was my time in your time. So he was playing with these things. We have these holograms, which are very interesting. But anyhow, so what I want to say, we can record wavefronts and we can replay them. Not perfect today. Give me another 5 years, maybe I will have even more super realistic images. We also, of course, have seen samples from Chantier. Although Chantier has a very complicated process, he told me it takes 24 hours to process his hologram from when he has recorded it until it's finished. So that means that it's not really practical, and of course he's not selling any of his material. Okay, thank you for your attention. Do you have any questions? Melissa? You may have to come up here and
okay. I've worked with a lot of color processes over the years, and it is interesting. There's the missing component, I think, is now the lighting. It's like the lighting's stupid, you know, like you were pointing out, because we have this technology now to give us such precise control in the recording and the processing, and then we have all these like haphazard lighting situations. So maybe that's the next step, is the consortium of the lighting people to get the perfect light, the standard light.
And also could really help that, because to design nice looking display systems, and this is maybe, we have all these fancy problem with wavelengths we can solve, but the most, how to put a spotlight onto a hologram, that has never been solved properly. They are not, this is one of the, this is, yes, you can. This is one of the few we have in Britain that we got from America. They are going to be introduced. I don't know, we paid like $50 or so for this light. And one more question, and then we have to proceed.
Sure. Hans, we're all looking forward to edge-lit holograms. Do you see a time? Are there any special problems associated with edge lighting full-color holograms that are different from edge lighting monochromatic holograms would be the first question. And then the second question is, do you see a possibility for using super bright LEDs, the kind that go red, green, blue in rapid succession, as a possible means of edge lighting full-color holograms?
I mean, yes, I can answer here. No, I think that this thing with the edge-lit has been talked of, and a lot of people have worked with. Nobody have been able, except small holograms, can be like 4x5 plates. Nick Phillips worked a lot on it. Benton has worked on it, and a lot of people. And, of course, when you come into color, it's even more difficult. You must realize that you enter light at the bottom of a plate. If you have a plate 2 meters high, how can you get the same amount of light up there? So you will have a fading image going up. Or you have to find a very special technique of distributing, starting with extremely little light that increase along its way up there. Nobody has a solution, and I don't know how to do it. I hope somebody else will work on it. I mean, the other thing is called extreme angle illumination, but again, you just get the projection of that light hitting, so you